The saga of the death of Michael Jackson continues, and we welcome a very special guest tonight, Dr. Arnie Klein. They called the dermatologist to the stars, easily the best known dermatologist in Southern California, maybe elsewhere too. He's Michael Jackson's longtime dermatologist friend, and he's a professor of medicine and dermatology at UCLA. Doctor, how did you first meet Michael?
I met Michael because someone had brought him into my office. I walked into the room with Michael, and I took one look at him. I said, "You have lupus erythematosus." Now, this was a long word.
Lupus.
Lupus, yes. I mean, because he had red butterfly rash, and he also had severe crusting you could see on the anterior portion of his scalp. I mean, I always am very visual. I mean, I'm a person who would look at the lips of Mona Lisa and not see her smile. I would see the lips.
Was he there because of that condition?
He was there only because a very close friend of his had told him to come see me about problems he had with his skin, because he had had severe acne, which many people made fun of, and he used to remember trying to clean it off, and he'd gone to these doctors, but it really hurt him very much, and he was exquisitely sensitive to pain, so he walked into my office. He had this terrible thing wrong with his skin, so I said, you have thick crusting of your scalp, and you have some hair loss. He said, "Well, how do you know this?" I said, "Because of the natural course of lupus." So I then did a biopsy. I diagnosed lupus, and then our relationship went from there.
Let's fast forward. You saw him the Monday before he died.
Absolutely, yes, sir.
What was the purpose of the visit?
He came to me because basically I was sort of rebuilding his face because he had severe acne scarring. He had scarring from having a lot of cosmetic surgery. And my expertise is like it is with every one of my patients. My patients are my treasures. And I was rebuilding his face so he looked much more normal. I mean, contrary to what people said, he could not take off his nose. His nose was attached, but it looked too small. And I just was trying to get him ready to do the concert because in the way he looked in his face, he wanted to be absolutely as perfect as it could be.
Did he consult you when he was doing his plastic surgery?
No. I mean, I came onto the scene long after he'd begun plastic surgery. In fact, what I wanted to do is, stop it because I felt that, we were losing body parts in the situation.
You know why he was such a good-looking young man, why he even started with plastic surgery?
I don't know, because I can't definitively say, but I know that people made fun of family members of the size of his nose. He was very sensitive to that, and so he started doing cosmetic surgery. And when you it's like, remember Tody Fields very well.
Yeah, we knew her well.
Her facelift, and she lost her leg. And the thing is, plastic surgery is unfortunate. If you want it done, there's someone who'll do it.
Correct. And how do you find the right one? I'll get to that in a while. How would you describe Michael's mental, physical condition on that Monday?
He was dancing in the office, so it's hard to say. So he was a very good physical condition. He was dancing for my patients. He was very mentally aware when we saw him. And he was in a very good mood because very happy. And
good.
I mean, it was a very, very happy mood.
So therefore, you had to be shocked when he died.
Oh, I remember when I found out, I sat at my desk for about 5 hours. I couldn't move because I was very close to him. It's not just because he's Michael Jackson, probably the most talented performer of our age. I mean, when I lose anyone that I know, having lost my brother and my father when I was in medical school, I don't do well with death.
A doctor should feel that way, right? Any
loss
is a loss to him or her.
I've taken care of many of your friends, and I have to tell you one thing. I give my life for my work. I have nothing else.
Was Michael in any kind of pain when you saw him?
Not whatsoever.
Now, there are reports, Doctor, that his body was riddled, I want to get this right, with needle marks when he died. Did you see any evidence of needle marks?
Well, I didn't examine his entire body.
Have you seen any in prior exams?
No, I never saw needle marks on his body. I mean, I never saw them that I could tell you, but I didn't see a riddling of anything. People sound like he looked like he was made of there were holes in him, and there weren't anything like that.
Reports he was emaciated.
He wasn't emaciated. I mean, I know dancers because I've worked with dancers many times, and dancers are very concerned by their weight. And so I knew that he always wanted to be thin, and I talked to him about eating enough and making sure he didn't overexercise because some dancers, in order to remain thin, will overdance in order to keep their weight down.
Would you call him a good patient?
I thought he was a great patient.
I don't have any
bad patients.
Okay. Well, some patients are not as cooperative as others.
Oh, absolutely.
Don't listen to the doctors. Well, what about pain-killing medications? Did you prescribe any?
I mean, I've used some sedatives for, you know, when he had surgical procedures that are immense, because don't forget, he had the burn, a severe burn, when he was burnt on the Pepsi commercial, and the severe hair loss when he, you know, contracted lupus also. So when you have to fix all these areas, you have to sedate him a little bit. But if you took all the pills I'd given him in the last year at once, you wouldn't do anything to him.
What was the strongest medication you gave him?
I gave him Demerol to sedate him, and that was about the strongest medicine I ever used.
You've worked with addicts, have you not?
I wrote a book on heroin addiction, and I mean, I think what's happening with drugs now is a disaster. I mean, we look at the actor from the Batman. I mean, look what happened to him.
Yeah.
You have him, you have Michael. And the thing to remember from this, you have all these drugs now that they're being prescribed, the pills like Oxycontin, available on our high school campuses. And I think we have to do something about the readily availability of these drugs.
Michael, we're going to get to that in a while. Did Michael have an addiction you were aware of?
Michael at one time had an addiction. And he went to England and he withdrew that addiction at a secure setting, where he went off of drugs altogether. And what I told Michael when I met him in this present situation when I was seeing him, that I had to keep reducing the dosage of what he was on, because he came to me with a huge tolerance level. I mean,
wow.
When you take drugs repeatedly, unless you have something like your kidneys don't work, you may require some larger doses than normal.
Diprovan.
Diprovan.
Okay, now let me just, I never get personal, but I had cataract surgery. They knock you out for a little while, you wake up, and suddenly it's gone, and you feel fine. And they gave me Diprovan.
It's a wonderful drug when used correctly.
It is used by anesthesiologists.
Right, because it's a very short-acting drug. It's very metabolized very quickly. You go to sleep, and it's gotten rid of from the body very quickly.
But what would it be doing in someone's house?
I have no idea, and that's what doesn't make sense to me. And it's like anything. I mean, it's the danger of all these substances that are available that people can get, because the very rich and the very poor, the rich and the famous can buy anything they want to buy.
Yeah, but how would you buy Diprovan?
Well, you can get it from an anesthesiologist.
But he'd have to come to your house. Would you do it in your house?
No, certainly not, unless you had an anesthesiologist administering it to you. There are certain things that you have to not do. And the one thing you have to know is what you're doing with medication. And medicine is not something casually. I mean, I developed certain things in my life. Not a lot, but the sites I use Botox on, certain injectable fillers. And, I mean, that's my life. And, I mean, the big thing that I see is you see so many people giving Botox parties and things like this, and this makes no sense to me.
I want to talk about medicine. All right. Did Michael tell you he used Diprovan?
I knew at one point that he was using Diprovan when he was on tour in Germany. And so he was using it with an anesthesiologist to go to sleep at night. And I told him he was absolutely insane. I said, you have to understand that this drug you can't repeatedly take, because what happens with narcotics, no matter what you do, you build a tolerance to them.
How could a reasonable anesthesiologist give that to someone other than prior to surgery?
Because I have to tell you, there are certain people in this world who are not reasonable. I mean, integrity in medicine doesn't...
Wouldn't you lose a license if you were giving it for other than...
It's anesthesiology. I mean, people have used everything for everything. But there are so many... I mean, let's not go and get me into the topic of integrity in medicine now. Because, I mean, that's what's happening in the FDA and all the recommendations of drugs. So
are you surprised that Diprovan was found in his home, supposedly?
I am very shocked by it, but I have to tell you that it's not something that would be unheard of, because I told him that this drug was very dangerous to use.
And what
did
he say when you told him?
Well, he listened to me. But you can't be absolutely sure that you're going to force anyone. I spent half a year living with heroin addicts and writing a book about my experiences when I was in medical school, when I went to England after the death of my father and brother. And what I learned from the experience is you couldn't really ever be assured that you're getting honest information from someone who's an addict.
Because they lie.
Well, they lie because they want to procure medication.
Did you ever see any IV-type equipment in his house?
Never.
Do you ever see Diprovan in his home? Do you ever see it anywhere?
No.
Associated
with it? I never did, and I also told him specifically the dangers of the Diprovan, the dangers of getting it used by someone who is not an anesthesiologist or someone very...
Did he have an insomnia problem?
Not that I knew of, except that once we went on tour with him, we were in Hawaii, he couldn't get to sleep, so my whole office went to sleep in the room with him. So I never knew that he had a problem with sleep until this whole tour came up, or basically this problem with sleep at that time. I do know that he did certain, local anesthesia, But this is not something we discussed repeatedly, except I just got shocked. He assured me it stopped.
And he never asked you to administer it, did
no.
he?